Nobody knows the future. I often speak at these conferences where there's a panel of people and a moderator that says a question like, what is the future of the music business? And the funny thing is, if there's a guy who's in the business of selling MP3s, he'll pipe up and say, the future of the music business is selling MP3s, and blah, 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 we've got proof of this, and trust me, everybody else is wrong, the future of the music business is selling MP3s. And then if you have a guy over here whose business is, say, digital radio, he will tell you, the future of the music business is digital radio, all these people are wrong, nobody wants to buy MP3s, it's digital radio, that's what everybody wants. The thing is, nobody knows. Everybody's just kind of talking as if, you know, saying it enough will make it come true, or spouting their corporate interest. But they're all full of crap. Nobody knows. And if they would just admit that nobody knows, or just have the courage to say, I don't know, nobody knows, then we could start having a real intelligent conversation. The funny thing is with a lot of entrepreneurs is they put so much attention into this business plan. And I think there's a little bit of an unfair emphasis on this idea of doing the 5-year projections and having people work out the numbers 5 years into advance and saying, well, what's going to happen in 4 years? What's going to happen then? The problem is that your business plan is moot because you don't know. And the reason that you can tell that business plans are always fiction is that all those numbers, those little bar graphs, they're always going up, 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 up. And you know, not every business turns out like that. So if you admit that you don't know, there's this great saying, I think Steve Blank in California said this, that no business plan survives first contact with the customer. I love this idea, that no matter what you've got planned, once you get out into the real world, it's all gonna change. So, my little example, with CD Baby, when I started this thing in 1997, I really thought it was going to be just a payment processor. Again, this is like before PayPal existed, right? But that's kind of what I had in mind. Like, I got this credit card merchant account for myself, and I was just gonna let my friends use it, and I would just charge a dollar or something like that for them to use it. So I made this little site. My first version of cdbaby.com was really just me and 10 friends, where I had their CDs there. And some guy from the Netherlands came in and bought a couple CDs, shipped them to the Netherlands, and then a week later, he came back and sent an email saying, hey, where are your new arrivals? And I said, new arrivals? What do you mean? Like, which of my friends am I now processing credit cards for? Why do you care? And he replied back saying, oh, I thought you were a store. I'm sorry. And I said, oh, a store. I had never thought about that. Yeah, I could be a store. So just like that, my plan completely changed. I was like, yes, I'm gonna make a store, cdbaby.com, it'll be a store, awesome. And so for the next 6 years, I did everything I could to try to make it the best little store I could. Then in 2003, I get this email from Apple, just after they had launched the iTunes Music Store, inviting me up to their office to talk about getting the entire CD Baby catalog up and selling in the iTunes Music Store. So went into the Apple office and there was just a little room and I just assumed we were going to be talking to one of the marketing people or whatever. And Steve Jobs himself walks out. I was like, whoa, hi. And he went into full presentation mode, like, we want to get every piece of music ever recorded up and selling in the iTunes Music Store. We want your entire catalog, even the stuff that isn't selling well, even the stuff that might be out of print. We want every piece of music ever recorded. And so all I really had to do was say, okay. And I told you, Forrest Gump. I said, okay. And now I'm a distributor. So just like that, our plan completely changed. And then CD Baby became one of the biggest distributors of independent digital music into all of these big outlets like Amazon and iTunes and Napster and Rhapsody and all of those. So if you just admit up front that nobody knows the future, you can actually plan accordingly. It means that you get into more of a listening mode. Say that you can look at a problem and think that it's a worthy problem to solve and admit that you don't know the answer, but you're going to try to find out or continually try to find out the answer as it will change through time. So if you get into this mindset, then you can ask questions more than answer questions and you can learn more instead of preach more. And I just find it's a better mindset to be in.